everyone. So here's a quick walkthrough of your patterns. This is for the trench coat. Through this tutorial, I'm going to provide you with a letter size print set of the trench coat patterns. This letter set prints 57 pages. I know it's quite a lot, but it does include many sizes which are graded, the smallest outline being the smallest size, the largest outline being the largest size. So always test your prints. Make sure you're printing at actual size and start with page number one. So your test square on page one should measure 2 by 2 inches, and then you can continue with the rest of the packet according to the settings. Again, you should choose to print this at 100%, which is typically actual size. So just print your test square first. That is for your letter size of prints. Another option for your set of patterns would be to do A0, which is large format. You can do this at Kinko's. There are services online that do it at very affordable prices with very little cost for shipping. So be sure that you print all three pages on the first page. And again, this applies to when you're printing this through an online service. They're a little bit more lenient with reprints if they print the scale incorrectly. So I would suggest if you go to FedEx, Kinko's, just be sure that you're very clear in the comment section when you send this file over for printing. Be sure to use the 2 by 2 inch square. That way it covers you in case they print it to the wrong scale. So you've got that 2 inch square, 2 by 2, that's on the first page of your A0 format. And just double check with your ruler and you're good to go. When assembling your letter size patterns, there's a key here, so you'll just clip out your pattern pieces and assemble them to match up that shape. There's also a format of the layout for your letter size prints, so be sure that you look at that when you start assembling these, and I hope that you enjoy this tutorial. If you choose not to do a lining for this trench coat, be sure that you cut two of your front facing instead of two of your front pieces. That way they correspond to the back neck facing. That means if you are not doing a full lining, you are cutting the two front facing pieces, four in fabric, and you'll cut one of your back neck facing. So your two front facings will serve as obviously the facing, but they'll also serve as the outer piece of your front pieces of your lapel that will join to the back neck facing. This is no lining. If you are using a lining, be sure that you are using the front piece of the pattern, which you'll cut four out of, and then you'll cut them in self, and you'll continue with the remainder of the pieces in the lining fabric. Make sure that if there's any indicators for interfacing, such as this line here, that you're cutting your fusible interfacing for the cap of your sleeve, so the top sleeve, as well as your undersleeve, which also has an interfacing indicator, which we're gonna find. When you're cutting your fabrics, be sure that you don't forget your notches. That's really important. So that section will be an interfacing. That means that you cut the sleeve pattern full in fabric and you cut a set in your lining, if you choose to do the lining, but the interfacing piece itself goes on top of. So do not remove that piece. That just means this section itself is having the interfacing. So that section only applies to your sleeves. Make sure that when you are cutting for a fully lined garment, be sure that you follow along with the instructions that go with the pattern pieces for your cutting. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate to email or comment on Patreon. Once you've cut out all of your self panels, which are going to be your two back panels, you should consider pinning those together right sides facing. After you've pinned these two closed, you can choose to start sewing down center back and stopping at the top of the vent.
My approach was to attach my side back pieces down what's called the princess seams. Princess seams are typically running down the apex or between the center front and the side seam or the center back and the side seam. So we call these the princess seams. Once I have these pin basted, I'm going to sew them at 3/8 of an inch seam allowance, and you'll have the self panel of your back sewn together. You can consider to repeat this for your lining set, so it's really the same approach. Consider that when you're making this trench coat in particular, that the pattern is being cut twice for yourself and for your lining. You'll have to read along with the pattern pieces to be sure that you're not cutting anything incorrectly. Afterwards, you're going to want to add your fusible interfacing to the wrong sides of your facing pieces. If it's your first time using fusible interfacing, be sure that you place the rough side of the fusible to the wrong side of your fabric. Use a little bit of heat and steam. And I would consider in the future, or if it's your first time using fusible interfacing, to be sure that you use a pressing cloth. While pin basting your side front and your front panels together, make sure that you're aligning your notches. Your notches are your best friends, and they're really going to help because if you pin the notches together first, the bottoms together first, and the top end together first, then you can ease everything in between to each other. You're going to be sure that you do this twice, and after you have cut and sewn those front panels together, you're going to want to use your iron and be sure that you use a pressing cloth or at least try a sample of pressing first so that you don't damage your fabric. I like pressing my fabric from the right and the wrong side just to double check that everything was pressed openly and it looks right on the outside of the fabric. After you've pressed all of your seams open, we're going to move on to attaching our side panels at the side seams. We're going to talk about the vent a little bit later in the process, but it's really important to press before you attach any of your pieces together. When cutting your self fabric and your lining fabric, just be sure to not add additional seam allowance because 3/8 seam allowance is already included. And it's really important, again, to align your ends of your fabrics first. As you're sewing down your side seams, be sure that you attach them at the underarm first with your pins and then at the hem. And then you can sew up both of those areas. As far as your pocket placement, you can decide on that now. You can decide on it later on. I think the best point in the sewing process to decide where you want your pockets, where you want to put in your belt loops, which I'm going to show you how to custom make along with a custom made belt, is after you've sewn and pressed open your shoulders and side seams, try the piece on and determine, all right, am I gonna wanna have a belt? I don't need a belt. What types of pockets do I want? I use a wooden clapper with my pressing and I find it to be very convenient because it helps to just kind of reinforce the steam and the heat into the fabric. If you don't have one, you can just use your tailor ham and lay that right over your seams after you've pressed them open. And now we're going to move on to the next step. Moving on to our collar. So when you're cutting your collar pieces, you want to be sure that you can distinguish the right from the wrong side because we need to place fusible interfacing onto both sets of your collar before they're attached to each other. There's two methods to attaching your collars. The most simple and straightforward way would be to interface both on the wrong sides, close up the center back of your under collar, and then if you'd like and you're not going to line your entire garment, then you will also use that back neck facing, which is the last piece we just took a look at. After you've sewn your under collar, you want to be sure that you press that seam allowance open. You can press it from the right side as well, just to reinforce and make sure that it's laying nice and flat. We don't want to have that extra bulk in your garment. You're going to have to attach your collar stands and be sure that those are fused as well. And make sure that you're also not running out of bobbin. That's one of my worst habits ever, is that I don't realize, like, oops, I ran out, and then I have to stop and start all over again. I like to trim up my fusible interfacing. Again, it's a non-woven, so that means it does not have a grain line for the most part, depending on what type of interfacing you're using. When I attach my collar stand and I've trimmed off any excess of my fusible, I start at my ends first, match up my center backs, and then I'm going to sew this up using 3/8 of an inch seam allowance. You can also add an understitch if you like, and make sure to repeat this process so you attach your collar stand to your top collar. The top collar is what will be showing on the outside or when the collar is worn traditionally. So just be sure that you're really careful with your sewing and that it's looking very elegant when you're finished. I love a good understitch when it calls for this option, and that's just by sewing between 1/16 and 1/8 of an inch from your stitching line. And what it does is it keeps all of those seam allowances pushed toward the bottom, or what will become the bottom edge. In this case, it's the seam allowance that's joining onto our collar stand, and it just adds a really nice finished look. It takes a bit of practice because it is technically going to show as a top stitching on the right side of your garment. So I would say practice first with some scrap fabric. It's not something that you need to do, but it does add a really nice finishing touch, and it just really helps and reinforces that seam allowance to act as almost like a stabilizing factor. In any cases where you do have rounded seams, be sure that you clip those to release the curve. And this applies when you're attaching collar stands, when you're setting sleeves into armholes. In this case, when we are attaching the sleeves to the armholes for this particular trench coat, there is no easing in the cap, so you don't have to clip your seam allowances, but if your fabric is a little bit heavier weight, I would highly recommend clipping those seam allowances. Here I'm just clipping away at the dog ears, which are just the extra bit of seam allowance that kind of hangs out from pressing both of those seam allowances down toward the collar stand. Blech, that's a lot of stuff. All right, so we're going to repeat the same process that we've gone through for everything so far with our lining pieces. Make sure that you are attaching that facing self that we put the fusible interfacing on, attaching that to your lining pieces. In this case, the only reason that I have seams on my lining pieces is because I used some remnant silk fabric. And I thought, you know, it's going to add a really nice touch. It's going to be super lush on the inside and soft and just, yeah, I thought I would throw myself a curveball. It ends up looking really cool, but in the future, make sure you have enough fabric. And unless you want to get really crafty, then use something that is remnant. So if you decide to use the neck facing option, this would be in the instance that you are not fully lining your trench coat. You would only attach your neck facing piece to your front facing pieces. So remember, this is not using a lining. It's optional, but it is a really pretty touch and it's a lot less work. Moving on to sleeves. So in this case, what you're going to do is you're going to pin your undersleeve to your top sleeve with right side spacing and close up both of those inseams. In this case, it just gives a little bit more flexibility with the fit, and you're going to align them at the top and the bottom edges, align your notches, and then close up both of these ends with 3/8 of an inch seam allowance. And then we will set them into those armholes. Really exciting stuff. Be sure that you press these seams open before you set them into your armholes, and we'll move on. If you don't own a Taylor ham or Taylor sausage, you can always just roll up some remnant muslin or an old t-shirt or towel and use that for pressing open your sleeves. We're going to move on to your center back of your lining. Again, we're going to close up center back until we hit that vent. In this sample, I do show you how to cut the center back without a vent for your lining. I would not recommend to cut your lining and your self-set differently, but I wanted to be sure that I could show you two options, because if you do decide not to use the vented back, you can literally just fold it back and extend that center back, cut it straight down as you would, still two pieces, and then you just leave that amount of inches open. Then you just clean finish your lining to yourself, and you've got just a clean center back with a little bit of wiggle room instead of having a classic vent. So just as we attached our front panels to our side front panels before we attached our shoulders and our side seams, you're going to repeat the same for your lining. After we've done that, we're going to set those sleeves in, and then we're going to do a little bit of work on our collar pieces so that we can sandwich everything together, and it makes it for a really simple assembly. Now with our storm flap at center back of your back storm flap, we're just going to clip in those three notches. We're going to pleat them so that we bring them to meet center back. And you can place a pin. We're going to end up putting in a basting stitch that's no more than an eighth of an inch from that top edge of the neckline, and that's going to keep your pleats in place. So you're going to want to just try your best to get these to look a bit uniformed so that we can press them and it just keeps that crease nice before we attach them to the neckline of the rest of the jacket. You can use a baby rolled hem. Here you have a baby roller hem foot, or you can just turn up those edges. If your fabric is not super heavy or you just have some remnant lining fabric, you can even sew your storm flaps right sides together and then clip and flip them so that you have a nice clean edge. I'm just putting this out there that the baby rolled hem is not easy, and you want to use thread to match so that you don't see it. Once you've hemmed both of your front storm flaps and your back storm flap, you also want to clean finish that front edge of your storm flaps so that you don't see it from the right side of the garment. Once you've sewn up the shoulders and what would be considered the side seams of your storm flaps, we're going to baste with pins by aligning the side seam and the shoulder seam along with all the notches along the armhole. Then we're going to run this to the machine and put in a running stitch, which is going to be an elongated stitch just on your longest stitch length on your machine. And this is just going to keep the storm flaps in place before we set in the sleeves. That was a mouthful, but here's a preview of the sleeves having been set in. So it's looking really cool so far. I've attached the collar, which I do not recommend doing just yet, but I just wanted to see how everything was sitting together for a fitting. I know that setting in sleeves is pretty self-explanatory, but I just wanted to be sure I gave you a preview. To be sure that you are setting in the correct sleeve to the correct side, you're going to notice that the undersleeve has a higher peak in the back of the sleeve. You're going to match up the inseam notch of the sleeve, which falls between it's in the center of the undersleeve. So I'm sure you've clipped that notch, and that's what aligns the side seam. Then you're going to match up the top of the sleeve notch to the shoulder seam of your shoulder seams. You get it. I know it's really wordy, but I'm sure you've all set in sleeves before. Match up all your notches and then place pins in between each of them. Set in both of your sleeves to yourself, set of the trench coat, and set in both your sleeves to your lining, set of the trench coat. Once you've done your running stitch to attach your armhole of your storm flaps to your self set of the trench coat, you're also going to want to put in a running stitch for the back neckline just to keep all of that in place before we attach the collar.
All right, so once you've got your collars attached to their stand, you're going to sew the two collars together. They're going to be right sides facing, and bear in mind that your under collar with the seam is joining to your self jacket, because as you're wearing this, you don't want this seam visible as the collar is going to turn down and come around the neck. So with our collar, under collar and collar stand, and our top collar and collar stand attached, I've done an understitch here where you just attach both seam allowances to the self, and it just gives a nice clean finish. For the curve here, you can clip in the seam allowance to release. Then you're going to bring the two together, and you're going to sew the side across the top and down the side as well. Be sure you clip your seam allowances in corners so you can flip that and get a nice pointy collar edge. Once those two are together, you're going to put them into your lining layer and yourself. The under collar is going to go toward my self layer here. You're going to align your center back notch with the center back notch of yourself. And then your top collar will go in facing your lining. Again, remember, this is going to turn out. You're going to see the top collar that's closest or facing to your lining as I flip this. So I'll show you what that looks like from the right side. You can see I've got it pinned across, and I've started pinning across my lapel. You're going to pin, it's almost going to look like cat ears. So it'll be across the collars, and this is the center back of your bodice pieces, up your lapel, down your lapel at center front. So you're sewing one, two, across, one, two, down. And then from the right side, I can just pull my collar up and through. So that'll be top collar to lining, under collar to self. So as you're wearing this and it's sitting up, curves down around the neck, you don't see the seam from your under collar. Then I'm going to run this through my machine with my 3/8 seam allowance, do my cat ears, boom, boom, across, boom, boom. So after you've sewn any of your corners, I've mentioned this before, it's just kind of like a basic rule of thumb. Anytime you've sewn anything that comes to an angle, I like to just run my back tack over that just as a reinforcement so that when I clip close to the edge or close to that angle, that my stitches don't unravel. So you're going to do that in the collar and those pointed edges of the lapel. Also in my hem edges, what I do is I run my stitching to down my center front, and then I usually stop where my lining starts, and then I'll clip that and flip it.
So before hemming the jacket, you want to be sure that you take time to make your belt and belt loops. It's a good point to stop and just take a break from all of that assembly. What I did here is I cut some remnant fabric to make a belt that's going to be self-tying. I started with 1.5 inch wide, and I'm pressing in 3/8 of an inch from the length sides towards the wrong side. And then I'm going to press over one more time and do a top stitching to close. And this is a good trick for making straps for a tote bag or any other type of accessory. Then I'm going to press a second time, and before I stitch it closed all down the length, I'm going to stitch closed the top and bottom ends, and this will leave me with a really nice clean finish.
Thank you. So in this case, I would do the pocket before I hem the coat, and definitely do some practice of the welt pocket of your preference before you do it to your actual trench coat. With your pocket patterns, you have the welt itself. You can see I have two pieces of interfacing here. I've got my two welts and I have my two pocket bags. So this allows for you to have a slanted welt. Again, you can choose your location. And the beauty of it is you can measure for up from the hem to pick your level or the area where you want to place the top end or even the bottom end of your pocket, because with that, you have a straight edge along the bottom of your pocket bag and your welts will be the only part that's exposed. So let's say I want to have my pocket start 2 inches from my princess seam here, and I want it to be 11.5 inches from the bottom edge of the coat. You can place pins as just placeholders so that when you step into the mirror, you can say, okay, is that where I want my pocket to be? And then from the inside, I would do your markings and start applying your welts. All right, for hemming the sleeves, and this is just like one of my less complicated approaches, something really funny about garments that you might already own is, and it's something that you'll never notice because you can't see it, is that they'll close the entire coat. They'll attach the linings to each other, they'll attach the sleeves to each other, all that good stuff, and they'll actually leave the inseam of the sleeve unsewn and flip the whole jacket right side out through that. Then they just pinch their seam allowances together and do a top stitch, and that's how you end up with a fully cleaned garment. So look inside some of your tailored pieces, maybe you'll see that, but for our sleeves, we've pinned them wrong sides together. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to unpin and I'm just going to turn down so that I've got my right sides facing each other. And I'm going to place a pin there again. And what's really important about this approach is to double check that your sleeve lining has not twisted. So now I'm going to place a pin here so I have right sides together. And it's gonna look a little bit tortured and twisted, but that's the intent. We wanna be sure that it's all, you know, together so that when we reach up through the lining and we bring those sleeves, self and lining corresponding, out through the hem of the jacket, we're gonna end up with almost like a tube here. So we're going to bring those right sides together that we've already pinned in the last step. And depending on what your sleeve allowance is going to be, you can even draw that on with a ruler before you start sewing. In my case, because I'm going to take off 2 inches, I have to be sure that it's going to be consistent. You can always put a guide on your machine too. Just whatever is easier for you to follow visually. So I'm going to continue pinning around the full circumference of these sleeves. And this would be the point where, you know, you could do your markings, you can use chalk, whatever is the best visual for you. So here I've got my 2 inches. And that's quite a lot, so it's going to be a little tricky when I get to the machine so I can be sure that it's consistent. An easier approach would probably be to shave off 1 inch from the hem of myself and my lining and then just hem it at 1 inch. But just for time's sake, get through this portion of the walkthrough. We're going to pin everything right sides together. Make sure that your seams are aligning to each other. Then you can ease the rest of lining to self in between those 2 points. You're gonna end up kind of like this. It's almost like they're high-fiving each other. So once I pin all the way around that, I'm gonna run back to the machine and I'm gonna sew. You can even baste this by hand just using a running stitch with needle and thread. That's easier for you. And then we're gonna place it into the machine like this so that we're only catching one layer, ignore my broken nail, only catching one layer of our sleeves at a time. So apparently I like torturing myself, and I did not trim down the seam allowance here. But you know what this is going to do? By leaving this extra bit, and although it's a bit more challenging, it's going to reinforce that hem edge of my sleeve. So I did the 2 inches. You can see how it almost looks like one continuous piece. So I would recommend trimming. I mean, it is an advanced approach, but now we've got our sleeves joined. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna push this back through the hem edge of my jacket, trench, and pull out my sleeve. So I'm not pressing this until after I've pulled it right side out. And even when I'm pressing this, so you can see now that they're joined to each other, I'm gonna cheat a little bit and I'm gonna keep about 1/8 of an inch of the lining into the jacket sleeves all the ways around. Always give a finger press or just a crease before I use heat. Then I'll repeat all of these steps for the opposite sleeve. I just have a little bit more pressing to do and my hems. And then she ready. Okay, so for assembling your vent, you're gonna close center back until the top edge of the vent here. And you're gonna do that for your lining and yourself of the coat. So what I've done here is just like a short and sweet sample of the 2 back panels. You've got a center back seam. And what we're going to do is we're going to attach vent of lining to self and vent of lining to self. So it almost looks like there's 2 little legs here. Again, these are right sides facing. So all I'm going to do is, and that's going to release. I noticed that even released my other piece there. And then I'm going to drop my needle into where my stitching left off. Do my reverse here just to reinforce where we left off from the previous stitch. And then I'm going to come down, pivot, and stop at hem. Then I'm going to repeat for the opposite side, and I'm going to flip this right sides out. Be sure to clip in those seam allowances there, and I'll show you after I've sewn that and how we're going to flip it to press it. So now that you've sewn both yourself and lining at either side to each other, you're going to turn one of them right side out and the other is going to stay inside. That's going to become like the pocket for your vent. So we're going to turn that side or that closed vent into itself so that you have your center back. It's going to look like that from the right side. If you'd like, you can do a top stitching here and only catch by using your stitch line for the top of your vent. You can just sew right over top of that. So you'll see some nice stitching, some top stitching from the right side. If you're too nervous, you can do a basting by hand first. So then your one vent will live inside of your other vent. Your center back will look nice and clean finished. And then from the inside, it will mimic the same.